is propagation models for 5G. One who has attended the previous session, NR technology standard, they can easily understand the concept why we require these propagation models for 5G communication. As we have discussed, basically for 5G communication, we are talking about the standards related to first frequency range, which is FR1, and second frequency range, which is FR2. So for FR1 and FR2, obviously these frequency ranges are below 6 GHz and above 6 GHz frequency ranges. So below 6 GHz, already we have propagation channel models. For example, if you studied this wireless and mobile communications, you must have studied about or read about this indoor propagation model and outdoor propagation models. And those indoor and outdoor propagation models are for these wireless communications frequencies of 900 megahertz, 1800 megahertz, 1900 megahertz. So the frequency bands for below 6 gigahertz, they have already defined the propagation models, just need to have some modifications as per the current scenario or the environment or the terrain, they need to modify. But still there are some researchers or there is literature available where you must have seen these lower frequency models also, and high frequency models are altogether. We need to define these high frequency propagation models. So that is why we have a altogether totally different topic for propagation models for 5G. So what is basically a propagation model? We just give a background in one two slide, and then we move towards the propagation models people are working on or the groups who are researching on for 5G. So if you see, whenever we want to communicate in any radio system, we need to communicate through a wireless channel. If we are transmitting or receiving through wireless channels, we need to cover some larger distance. And in between those distance from transmitter to receiver, there can be hills, there can be forests, buildings. So these are basically considered as terrains. So the type of terrain for different applications or type of terrains can be different, as we have seen in previous slide. That for 5G, we have different use case families. And under those use case families, obviously, we have different terrains will be there to cater those services. And those terrains are basically for transmission and reception of the signal. And those transmission and reception of the signal has been done with our transmitting and receiving antenna. So this, the distance between transmitter and receiver, which we are basically transmitting the data through their interface, this is called the channel. And channel means the medium over which the signal is propagated from transmitter to receiver. If you see, we have some building over here. We have transmitter and we have receiver. So this G node B, I'll just say now G node B, 5G base station. It is communicating with receiver because it is in the signal strength is received by this mobile phone, and this mobile phone is transmitting the data to the base station. But whenever we have a large buildings or high rise buildings, and we have mobiles related to this particular standard, which basically this base station is capturing. So obviously, if you see, there is no signal strength because we have this high rise building in between, and this particular base mobile station is not receiving signal from this particular base station. Similarly, we have another base station, and as per the distance from the base station, we have different signal strength. And you all know that you all are mobile user. You know that when we have an increase in distance from the base station, our signal strength decreases. Or when we have the nearby environment is such that our signal strength will decay, then it is not able to communicate with the base station, or it is not able to receive the signal strength from the base station. For example, in basements and lifts, where we have jammers and so on. So obviously, this is the condition. And this particular part is channel, and we need to identify how these propagation channels are changing with the change in frequencies or for new standards of frequencies we need to get. Similarly, for this diagram, it is shown that there are mountains, and in between the mountains, the forest areas or behind the mountains, this particular base station is not able to provide signal strength. Similarly, we have houses and trees. So, the main objective of these two diagrams is to show that as per the environment conditions, your propagation channels basically need to get up, and as per the requirements of those environment conditions, your propagation channels need to be defined. So whenever we have this channel model, it is also called a radio wave propagation model, and this radio wave propagation model, it characterizes radio wave propagation, and that propagation is the function of frequency, distance, environment, and other factors. It means, if you see in this previous slide, we just talked about the distance and we talked about the environment. But other than distance and environment, some other factors are there. And one of the major factors is frequency, on which frequency your signal is transmitting or receiving. And other factors, if you are in indoor environment, then the condition of the building, the material utilized for particular room, material utilized for in the particular corridor, or the number of rooms or number of partitions and so on. So, it means there are some other factors also which play an important role for characterizing the radio wave propagation. So, in other words, we can say that channel model provides us the rough idea, and that rough idea is about how much distance a signal can travel in a certain environment, whether it is an urban, suburban, or rural, etc., with a known transmitter and receiver height. Obviously, we know that what is the height of our transmitter, what is the height of our receiver, our antennas communicating to each other, what are they are in urban areas, they are in suburban areas, they are in rural areas, or they are in a open space or two. So it means these models basically provide us just the information, rough idea of the channel models. So when we have to define these channel models or radio wave propagation models, we need to find out some requirements. And these, in terms of 5G communications, we need to identify those requirements also. So the requirements of new channel models required to support 5G operation across frequency bands up to 100 GHz. Because we are targeting that we will cover up to 100 GHz, and for 100 GHz bands, we need to have some specific requirements. So few of them which listed in this slide is, one is should support large antenna arrays. As we have listed the term massive MIMO. Massive MIMO means the hundreds of antennas or large number of antennas, they are combined together, combined as an array, and now they are basically combined so that we can achieve high gain and high data. So to achieve these type of frequencies, better these type of frequencies, we first need large antenna array, and that too on high frequencies in millimeter wave bands. So it means this is the first list that large antenna array should support on high frequency bands, millimeter wave band. Then we should have large channel bandwidths. Those channel bandwidths are already defined by your frequency range 1, frequency range 2, and other modifications in TCP references. That you have different frequency ranges, and in those frequency ranges, you have these channel bandwidths available. Then, third is include joint propagation characteristics over different frequency bands to evaluate multi-band operation. As in use case implementation of 5G communication, the one major research area or one major concern is implementation of your low frequency bands cells and implementation of high frequency bands. It means integration of those frequency band cells, and after integration, obviously your low frequency band below 6 GHz frequency band has some different propagation characteristics, and your high frequency band will have some different propagation characteristics. So you need to identify joint propagation characteristics for different frequency bands so that this multi-band operation, that is low band, high band, carrier aggregation configurations can also be utilized efficiently. Then third, next point is it should accommodate the mobility up to approximate 500 km per hour. Because when we talk about this new generation technology or when we talk about future generation technologies, we need to look upon the mobility. Because up to 4G, we are able to achieve, you can say, high-speed network functionalities. It means we are able to achieve internet at anywhere, anytime. Speed is well-defined and okay. But when we are in mobility, obviously, when speed increases, there are some drawbacks which basically the current network is not able to provide those services. So that is why we are moving towards 5G communication, like in standby mode and in mobility, and that too at high speed. We are able to achieve the functionality, we are able to achieve high data rate, and we are able to transfer the data on high speed network. That is, mobility support should be there, and it should be extendable to support scenarios, because in current standards, in 2G, 3G, 4G current standard, we have propagation models, and those propagation models are basically that you are communicating from your mobile phone to base station, to your mobile phone to another mobile phone, and so on. But now, because we have different types of use case families, so obviously your applications are different, which means you need to get a device to device, you need to define vehicle to vehicle communication, and so on. So it is basically defined as V2X. It means vehicle is connected to X, and X can be anything, or it can be device to X, then your device can be connected to anything. So that is why you need to look upon this X point, that how these propagation models can justify, or they should be extendable to give their support to these standards. So these are the requirements of channel models for 5G communication. These are some of the requirements. There are many others, and in all the research papers, you look that there will be different requirements they have been, basically used, or they have identified that this requirement is justified by this model. This requirement is justified by this model. So when we talk about this radio propagation models for 5G communications, we have identified that these are the requirements we need to look upon. And whenever 5G communication system propagation model is to be implemented, it should be based on phantom cell concept. This is a concept implemented in radio propagation of 5G communication system. That what is phantom cell concept? That small cells are overlaid on macro cells. It means, again, the concept of integration of your small cells with larger cells, or integration of low frequency cells with high frequency cells. So this phantom cell concept means you have a small cell. One cell is having this, that suppose a radius of suppose 100 meter. Another cell is having this. It is having a radius of 500 meter. So it means this is your macro cell and this is your small cell, and you have to overlay that the small cells are overlaid on macro cells, so it can be implemented somewhere in there. So this macro cell base station, this is our macro cell and this is our small cell. So this macro cell base station is used for control signals, while the small cell base station is used for data signals. So whenever you have this small cell overlaid in macro, so this macro cell base station, if it is there, it is basically utilized to have control signal. Control signal means the signal which is required to make up a call, the signal or the parameters which is required to maintain a call, parameter to tear down a call, maintenance of this ongoing call, or the quality of this ongoing call. These are considered under control signal. So those control signals are handled by macro cell. And whenever it is time to transmit and receive the data, whether it is voice or any other type of data, it will be done through your small cell base station. So that is the phantom cell concept. And in 5G new radio high frequency bands, these characteristics of various types of propagations must be known. So one is the characteristics which is defined by New York University and METIS. METIS is already defined in previous slides in first session. It is basically part of the group, which is a European group, and it is working on the 5G communication implementation. So this New York University and METIS have reported several studies on 20 to 30 gigahertz and 50 to 70 gigahertz of frequencies. And second factors is affecting propagations are that whenever we talk about high frequencies, sub 6 gigahertz frequencies, you normally talk in terms that whenever there is a rain, you say, oh, there is signal strength variations, or there is no signal strength because there is rain outside. So that is the concept for low frequencies. You are using 2100 megahertz of frequency, or you are using 2.4 gigahertz of frequency, or you are using 5 gigahertz of frequency. So those are below 6 gigahertz of frequency, whether you are using Wi-Fi, whether you are using your mobile data, or you are using your 4G cellular base station with repeater. So these are for low frequencies. So you imagine if you are using that particular concept for high frequencies of 20 gigahertz, 28 gigahertz, 40, 70, 100 gigahertz of frequency. So it means that rainfall will have a major effect on this signal strength. So that is why these factors which are affecting propagations, one should be rainfall attenuation, because it has effect on the signal strength. Second is losses due to trees and plants, because whenever we have high frequency, obviously we need to have lower distance coverage. We will have lower distance coverage, and with these high frequencies, the attenuation is very large also. So losses due to trees and plants, and it is clarified in IPUR report, that radio communication report, international telecommunication radio communication report, that trees and plants are basically affecting these propagations at high frequencies. The effects of shadowing by human body. And if there is a human body and you are transmitting the signal and receiving the signal, so it is providing a shadowing effect. And this particular effect is considered a proposal for channel model from MY-VIBA. MY-VIBA is basically millimeter wave evolution for backhaul and access group, and it is working towards the implementation of millimeter wave propagation channel models. Then rough surface diffusion using ray tracing. So there are many factors which are basically having effect on radio propagation, and we need to study on these effects on the basis of the models people are working on or they are researching on for 5G communication. So when we talk about this 5G deployment scenario, in previous session we talked that whether it is in 5G standalone mode or it can be in non-standalone mode. But for this, they are considering that it is basically a 5G deployment. And under those 5G deployment, they can be outdoor propagation, they can be indoor propagation. So as per third generation partnership project, this 38.900 reference, if you look for this reference, you will get all the information related to this 3GPP release, that they have identified some deployment scenarios. And those deployment scenarios, one is urban micro scenario, which is defined as you or my. This is urban micro scenario, and under urban micro scenario, they have outdoor to outdoor communication, they have outdoor to indoor communication. It means in this urban micro scenario, you have micro cells. Those micro cells are in urban environment, and from urban environment, either those micro cells will have transmitters and receivers which are communicating in outdoor to outdoor scenario, and they can have transmitters and receivers which are communicating from outdoor to indoor scenario. So that is why they have O2O and O2I scenario. So whenever they work upon this urban micro scenario, because we are thinking the concept is that 5G will be implemented in urban scenario first, and that is for small cells. So after macro cells, there is a micro cell concept, means the radius of the cell is reduced, the power of the BTS is reduced, and so on. The first concept is for urban micro, having outdoor to outdoor communication and outdoor to indoor. So while deploying this scenario, the base stations, they are mounted below rooftop levels of the surrounding buildings. If you see that they have mounted below the rooftop levels of the surrounding building, it means these are high-rise buildings. They have implemented, if you see, they have implemented a base station over this rooftop level, and the surrounding building height is very high. This urban micro UMI open area model is intended to capture real-life scenarios. For example, a city or a station square. So they basically thinking the concept behind this model is that it should be implemented in a city, it should be implemented in some area where we have large buildings, we have small buildings, and we are implementing those areas. So this width they have considered as open area is in the order of 50 to 100 meter. An example for considering this, that they have considered a transmission height of 10 meter, receiver height of 1.5 to 2.5 meter, and they they are using this diffusion of 200 people. So it means they are implementing this urban micro concept for these two scenarios. And for implementation, they have considered some parameters, and using some mathematical calculations, they are implemented those scenarios, and they are looking for the propagation of those transmitters and receivers to those channels. Second is urban macro, which is considered as UMA. It is again with O2O and O2I, that is outdoor-to-outdoor and outdoor-to-indoor propagation. So in the deployment of this particular, if you say this is outdoor-to-outdoor propagation, that base stations are mounted above the rooftop levels of the surrounding buildings, and the transmitter height is now 25 meters, receiver height is this, and now they are considered specification of 500 meters. So in this, the transmitter height is 10 meters, but now here they, it is urban macro. So obviously the area coverage will be large, so transmission height is large and area coverage is large, which is of 500 meter. Yeah. So when we, if you see in this diagram, this is outdoor to outdoor propagation, that we have a transmitter here, we have a receiver here, and this is the propagation signal strength graph. That according to this color, they can identify that which is having received the best signal and which area is receiving the poor signal strength and so on. And this is basically for the indoor environment. If you see in this diagram, for indoor environment, they have identified that we have the base station, and inside somewhere we have some, you can say, router or a signal strength basically, and modem, and it is providing signal. So these are cabins. These cabins are partitioned, but they are not on high. So these are providing the signal strength. Accordingly, this is the transmitting antenna. These are the receivers, and they are receiving the signal strength. So as per the scenario, whether it is urban micro or urban macro, for outdoor to outdoor or outdoor to indoor, the deployment scenarios have been defined. And as per the deployment scenario, the transmission height and the receiver height has been defined. So when we talk about this indoor scenario, it means these deployment scenarios are intended to capture various typical indoor deployment. For example, your office environment, your shopping mall. If you must have seen that whenever you go into a market in a shopping mall, you are receiving the signal strength in a particular area, receiving very good signal strength, and in a different area, you are receiving very bad signal strength. Similarly for the office environment. So these are basically that where your particular transmitter has been installed, and where you are sitting, and what are the in between infrastructures between transmitter and receiver. So similarly, it is shown in this that the typical office environment, which is having open cubicle areas, it can also have walled offices, it can have open areas, it can have corridors, it can have wooden partition, it can have concrete partitioning, and so on. So it means as per the office environment, the signal strength will vary accordingly. So in this indoor environment, the base station is mounted at a height of 2 to 3 meters, either of the ceiling or the wall. So it means they have identified that whether whatever you are using, they are basically as per the scenario, you need to identify these parameters, and then you define the base stations or the transmitter height and the receiver height. So in basically indoor environment, you see that base stations, they are mounted at a height of 2 to 3 meters, either of the ceilings or the walls. And you must have seen these type of base stations, small base stations or modems on your walls and the ceilings, which are providing signal strength to the user. And second is that the shopping malls are often 1 to 5 stories high and may even open area shared by several floors. So it basically this concept shows that whenever you are planning to have a propagation model, you need to discuss so many parameters. If you are in outdoor environment, you have to discuss the nearby terrain. And if you are in the indoor environment, you have to discuss about the number of partitionings, the infrastructure related to wooden partitioning, glass partitioning, utilization of metal, utilization of your concrete in that particular building area. So here they have taken the example of shopping mall, where they have considered it in generalization. A shopping mall is of 1 to 5 story high, and they have into open area, closed areas, which are shared by basically several floors. Similarly, the base stations, which are mounted at a height of approximately 3 meters on the walls or ceilings of the corridors and the shops also. So in that consideration, if you consider about indoor areas, you have to consider transmission height of 2 to 3 meters, receiver height of 1.5 meter, and the area coverage is 500 square meter under these conditions. Another consideration for indoor and outdoor propagation is this back hall, which is including outdoor above rooftops, back hall in urban area, street cannon scenario, where small base stations are placed at a light post. So this is one of the new concept that this light pole slim site is considered as a base station, and if you so this is basically the base station and also a lamp post. So while looking it considered, it looks like a lamp post to the common user, but basically it is backhaul indoor outdoor above rooftop backhaul in other areas, or it is considered as a street cannon scenario. In street cannon means this particular base station is providing signal strength to a particular areas and in particular direction also. So these are considered as light post slim site for giving coverage as a small base stations. Then device to device, vehicle to vehicle conditions. In this device to device access in open areas, street cannon indoor scenarios, and vehicle to vehicle is a special case where devices are considered mobile or they are considered mobile devices. It means whatever scenarios you are considering, you have to identify the requirements, you have to identify the challenges, and then you need to define or you need to work upon the propagation channel model for that particular scenario. So on these issues and basically requirements, there are some groups and projects which are working on propagation model. First, I have already said it is METIS. METIS is Mobile and Wireless Communication Enablers for 2020 Information Society. Then MIVBA, which is Millimeter Wave Evolution for Backhaul and Access. Then IDUR for Bluetooth basically. Then COS2100. These are propagation models. COS2100 is also a propagation model. Then IEEE 802.11. Then New York University Wireless Lab, which is Interdisciplinary Technical Research Center. And from her, HHI has developed this quad rigor channel model. There are some other researchers also which are working on, but the basic channel models are identified by these groups. Then groups and peoples which are basically working on to have development on channel models. One is 5G Millimeter Wave Channel Model Alliance, which is basically IIMST initiated and North America based. And again is MM Magic, which is Millimeter Wave based mobile radio access network for fifth generation integrated communication, and IMP 2020, which is 5G Promotion Association, and this channel. So it means there are a lot of groups which are working towards the propagation channel model of 5G. So if you look for the first group, that is METIS channel model, they have identified 5G requirements, and their major consideration are the frequency ranges, high bandwidth, massive MIMO, 3D and accurate polarization model. After this identification of 5G requirements, they perform the channel measurement at various bands between 2 GHz and 60 GHz. So if you see, they have a wide frequency range, as they have mentioned that they are taking consideration at the wide frequency range. Then after making channel measurement, they provide the different channel methodologies. Those channel methodologies can be map-based model, they can be stochastic model, or they can be hybrid model. It means as per the area, they have identified the maps, and on the basis of maps and frequencies used and bandwidth and whatever concept they are considering, they provide some channel model methodology. For stochastic model, they have proposed the channels basically for outdoor areas, for indoor cafeterias, for shopping malls. And if we talk about MYVBA channel models, they address the shadowing effect, environment dynamics, and polarization. The proposed quasi-deterministic channel model was channel measurement at 60 GHz, focused at university campus, street cannon, hotel lobbies, backhauls, and device-to-device scenario. If you look, we have just looked upon two models now, two groups which are working on channel models, and they have altogether different scenarios for consideration. one model is considering a very wide frequency range, and if they are considering indoor areas and outdoor particular urban area. And similarly, second group is working on channel measurement at particular frequency of 60 gigahertz. They are basically working on university campus, and how university campus will work when they implement the 5G network there, then street channels, simple street areas, then hotel lobbies, how they will going to work, because cafeteria and hotel lobby, they will altogether have different scenarios. Then web call networks, how they are working, and device to device scenarios, how they are communicating with these ones at particular frequency of 60 gigahertz. If you see, there are so many options available under these channel models for different frequencies you can look upon for your particular future work also. Then IDUR channel model. These channel models basically address the propagation loss and atmospheric loss on millimeter wave. They are they have introduced an enabling antenna array technology, and they have proposed the deployment scenario which are focused on dense urban environment for high data rate service. So it means if it is considering dense urban environment, they are considering shopping malls, enterprises, roads, urban hotspots, and mobility in city. So this third group IPUR channel model, they are targeting these type of applications, use cases. And these channel models are particularly for the, you can say the EMBB and basically the mission critical services. Then POS 2.00 channel model, it is geometric based stochastic channel model, which reproduce the properties of MIMO channel over time, frequency and speed. So they have identified a MIMO channel based stochastic model, and it is a cluster level model where they have identified the large scale parameters, and they implement those parameters in channel instances, series of channel instances. Now, next model is, I'm just identifying the applications of those model, and then they have, I'll discuss one or two models, so that because it is totally a mathematical model concept, anybody who wants to work for these models, they can look for that particular model as per the application, and then they can go for their mathematical approach of those models. So next group is National New York University. Basically, they have identified the urban propagation measurements on these frequencies 28, 38, 60, and 70 gigahertz, both outdoor and indoor channel. They propose three areas basically for 5G millimeter wave channel modeling, and then they modified or extended those areas for propagation models for 6 gigahertz, below 6 gigahertz channel modeling. So it means first they have identified for 5G millimeter wave, then they modified or extended those 3GPP models for below 6 gigahertz channel modeling. So under those, they have considered line of sight model. Line of sight model, there is no interference, or there is no, you can say, hurdle or barrier between the transmitter and receiver. And then non-line of sight, it is not in direct contact with the base station. Then blockage modeling, which is basically an exponential term, that when you have maximum number of data traffic, so blockage will be here. So how you are going to apply those channel models? Then wideband power decay profiles, physics-based path loss models. And in these physics-based path loss models, they are basically using the existing 3GPP path loss equations and simply replacing those equations with the optimization parameter with free space reference term. It means the already available path loss models have been used, and those path loss models, they have just replaced this free space reference term with the floating optimization parameter. So it means instead of heat space, they are using this floating parameter. Then next is 802.11 base, which is AD and AY channel models, which are conducting on the basis of ray tracing methodology on 60 gigahertz band in those channels for conference room, cubicles, living room scenarios. And also the cluster parameters, which are basically considering human blockage models in terms of blockage probability and blockage attenuation. Then another model is from Huadriga Fraunhofer HHI. Huadriga Fraunhofer, basically their group of quasi-deterministic radio channel generator, and it is developed at the Fraunhofer Heinrich Herrick Institute so that we can enable the modeling of MIMO radio channels those VIVO radio channels for specific network configurations, for example, indoor, satellite, and heterogeneous configuration. If you see previously, all the models, they are working on urban environment, either macro, micro, and for outdoor and for indoor. But this particular model, they are working on VIVO radio channels and for indoor, satellite, and heterogeneous configuration. It supports massive MIMO modeling. It can be continuously extended by required 5G and beyond 6 GHz, and its model is supported by data from extensive traveling campaign and these frequencies. So they all the different models have different frequencies to support, different values to support. Some are using existing path loss models with some modification they are proposing for new frequencies, and some are using proposing a new models for different applications. So whenever we want to assess the performance of any 5G system, obviously we need to assess this multi-frequency path loss models, we need to assess line of sight probability and blockage models. So these models need to be developed across a wide range of frequency bands and for operating scenarios. So whosoever want to work for propagation models, it depends upon the requirement of propagation models, that for which type of environment the propagation model is required. So, when we talk about path loss models, the three path loss models are considered. One is close-in free space reference distance path loss model. Second is close-in free space reference distance model with frequency-dependent path loss component and alpha, beta, gamma path loss model. So, these are three models already considered for multi-frequency concepts for 5G communication system. So, one who want to work, they can look for these already available path loss models, and they can implement those path loss models for their current environment condition, whether for outdoor or for indoor propagation. So if you look for this particular three path loss models, close in reference, close in free, or alpha, beta, gamma models, you can see that this is the equation of path loss of close in reference frequency, and basically your distance is there in meters, and it is defined in dB. If any of you have seen the path loss models for 2G and 3G, you will or any of the indoor and outdoor propagation model, you can identify this. This is the equation of path loss model, and a particular condition it is for basically for this free space, you can say close in, which is this close in free space reference distance model. And in this model, they have this free space path loss model. The terms which are depending is frequency, which is in hertz, and this is the distance in meters, 10 into n log 10 b upon 1 meter plus xcif. So this f is defined as the frequency, n is basically path loss exponent. Path loss exponent is basically, as per the terrain, this n value is defined. For example, if you are in an urban area, and in urban area, you are having the high-rise buildings and vegetation is there. High-rise vegetation is there. So it means you'll have this one, you can say, value of n is equal to 2 or 2.5. Basically, this value ranges from 2 to 5. Any value of n is called the path loss exponent. And this path loss exponent is defined with the help as per the terrain. And this d, which is under this condition or this condition, it is basically the distance in meter. This xci sigma is basically the shadow fading, that whatever shadow factor or fading factor will be there, it is added here. So in this equation, they have considered the free space path loss, which is equation of n and meter, then distance with respect to 1 meter, and then the shadowing shadow, free space path loss at n 1 meter with frequency n, which is FSPL is given as 4 pi f by c. So basically this free space path loss equation, this part is calculated with this formula, where c is the speed of light, 3 to 10 to power 8 meters per second, and so on. If we discuss the alpha beta gamma path loss model, in alpha beta gamma path loss model, it is defined as 10 alpha 10 log 10 d in plus beta plus 10 gamma 10 log 10 f plus x a b c sigma. Where this alpha basically captures how the path loss increases as the transmit receive distance increases. So it means this particular alpha is defining the condition of signal strain or condition of path loss, that how this basically path loss is increasing when the transmitter and receiver distance is increasing. Similarly, beta is considered as a floating offset value and gamma is considered as the PL variation. PL means your path loss variation over the frequency in gigahertz, and this x, a which is sigma, is the shadowing fading with standard deviation in dB. It means if you see any of this equation, whether it is closing reference to the distance or closing alpha beta gamma model, path loss model, they have the defined parameters, and those defined parameters are implemented in certain situations, and finally they have identified these equations that in these conditions or in these scenarios, these equations can be implemented to calculate the path loss of that particular channel. So this closed-in reference PL model is an extension of CI model, and it is basically frequency-dependent PL model path loss exponent, which is given by this free space path loss for this equation of frequency and 1 meter distance plus 10 into this 1 plus Vf minus F0 by F0 and log V upon 1 plus X CI. So this N is again your path loss exponent. Your this V is an optimization parameter which will capture this log, and F0 is the fixed reference frequency, and this obviously is your shadow fading with standard deviation value. So all these effects are considering the shadow fading effects, distance, frequency, they are considering the path loss exponents, and as per the model they have some additional parameters with them. So then we up till now, is there any query? Okay, then we'll continue that in closed-in reference path loss model, we have considered only a single parameter, path loss exponent, which needs to be determined through optimization to minimize the shadow fading standard deviation over the major PL data. It means when this path loss model is defined, we have to identify the single parameters, path loss exponent, and finally they will use that for optimization to minimize the shadow fading standard deviation. And if we are using CIF model, then two parameters optimizations are required. One is your path loss component, second is your V, which is basically this parameter, optimization parameter. Then in ABG, that is your alpha beta gamma PL model, there are three parameters, alpha, beta, and gamma, which need to be optimized to minimize the standard deviation. So, if you summarize these three models or any of the population path loss models, we need to minimize the standard deviation of shadow fading. And finally, the standard deviation shadow fading will obviously affect the path loss propagation values, and ultimately, going to observe the channel model on the basis of that particular concept. So it means when you have increase in path loss exponent value as the frequency increases, whereas the PLE is not very frequency dependent in outdoor UMA or UMI. So after observing all these models through different scenarios, there is one observation they have researchers identified, that increasing PLO value as frequency increases, it means whenever you have rise in frequency, your path loss exponent value, which is N, is going to increase. Whenever PLA is not, whereas the path loss exponent is not very frequently dependent in outdoor and your urban indoor scenarios. So, till now we have discussed different parameters, and on the basis of different parameters and different channel models defined by different groups, identified some observations on the closed reference, closing reference, or closing model or ABG model. Now we need to discuss about indoor channel models. So, indoor channel models are basically that you want to use channel models for high frequency. And high frequency means basically millimeter wave frequencies, that is 20 gigahertz, 30 gigahertz, 100 gigahertz, 60 gigahertz, 70 or 80 gigahertz. So whenever we talk about these type of frequencies, high frequencies, it means we are need to work on smaller wavelengths. And whenever we have smaller wavelengths, it will produce an increased sensitivity of the propagation wave. With this high frequency or smaller wavelength, they introduce this sensitivity in the propagation models. With this sensitivity, they show some frequency dependence of path loss as well as increased occurrence of blockage. So whenever it is having this type of high frequency models, they will show some frequency dependency of the path loss and also show the occurrence of blockage. Further, this penetration loss is highly dependent on the material and tend to increase with frequency. Penetration loss means whenever you are transmitting some signal, it is penetrating through different materials, whether the indoor environment. In indoor environment, is your building materials, glass, wood, metal, or concrete, or so on. So, with high frequencies, whenever you are penetrating your signal, obviously the penetration loss is increasing. And if this penetration loss dependent on the materials you are using to transmit in the environment, and it is obviously increasing with the frequency. So for this, a 3D indoor hotspot channel model has been defined, which is based up to 100 GHz, and they are based on extensive measurements done in the indoor. So under this 3D indoor hotspot channel model, there are open cubicle areas. There are walled offices, open areas, corridors, as defined earlier, that if we have a transmitter on the wall or it can be on the ceiling. And there can be partition walls, and those partition walls can be considered of materials like sheetrock, concrete, glass, or any other material. And these materials will have effect on these penetration losses, and obviously with frequency these losses will go through. So as shown in this is your transmitter. These are your receivers, and whenever you are propagating through these signals, this is your main lobe, and this main lobe is transmitting the data, and your receiver is receiving the signal strength, and you are penetrating those to different molecules. So this is another cabin, and this cabin is also receiving some signal, but with some low strength of the signal with their penetration losses. So this 3D indoor hotspot channel model will have line of sight probability. It is map based approach because all the extensive experimentation has been done. So these extensive experimentation has been done using this map based approach, and under this map based approach, they considered the transmitter and the receiver positions. Transmitter means their access points and their user equipment positions have been considered. And they have investigated this particular model on different indoor office environment. For example, one is open plan office with cubicle areas, that there is a large hall, and they have cubicle areas in that hall. For example, nowadays MNC culture is there, and in that MNC culture you have large open areas and only cubicles are there. So those cubicles are not of very high height, so they have low heights of those cubicles. Partitionings, and obviously it will have a different effect of this particular transmission on the receiver transmission reception. Similarly, closed plan office with corridor and meeting room, and third is hybrid plan office with both open and closed areas. So these are the environments currently available in your offices, or it can be possible to have these hybrid type of plans in your office environments. So for this particular area, 3D indoor hotspot channel model, the model fits the propagation in indoor office environment. The best of the three models are evaluated. So one is this line of sight propagation path loss model, in which this has a value of 1 when the distance between them is less than or equal to 1.2 meter. This model will have a value of exponential minus d minus 1.2.4.7 when it is from 1.2 to 6.5, and it is having a value of this when it is greater than 6.5. So this new model has a good fit to the data in an average sense, and it can be used for 5G in indoor hotspot scenario evaluations. However, the high variability between different deployments and degree of openness in the office area is there. So it means whenever we have different deployments and whenever we have different openness or in office areas are there, so the, as per the degree of openness, as per the deployment, there will be a variability in this path loss exponent equations. So this is that we can implement this model on the FSMs, but there can be variability and you can consider those variable parameters in your experiments also. So another method under this channel model is ray tracing method, propagation simulation technology. That is ray tracing method. In ray tracing method, they have used to estimate propagation characteristics in urban areas, and they are considering that the rays are emitted from transmitter and arriving at the receiver, and those rays are including paths which are comprising of rays arriving at the receiver after reflecting many times within the radio. It means you have a transmitter, you have a receiver. This transmitter and receiving arriving at transmitter is transmitting the signal, it is arriving at the receiver, but this signal also getting reflected and received at this. So they have so many reflections from within the building, and those reflections can be from edges of the building. It means you have this connection and with this get this. You have the building structure here, the signal structure on this. So it means it can be from edges of the building, it can be from the ground. So this is our ground, you are just reflecting and you are receiving. This is from the ground, you are just reflecting and receiving. It means under this ray tracing method, you are considering that you have to estimate the propagation characteristics under urban environment. And in those urban environment, you have a transmitters and receivers. Whenever signal is receiving at the receiver, it is having one direct path and it is having many times different paths also. So those reflections received at the receivers are from edges or from the ground. As shown in this, that this is particular transmission point, this is reception point. So we need to transmit this signal, but instead of directly, because it is not directly in concept, they have some structure here, they have some structure here, they have some structure here. This is some structure, this is building and also. So they have direct signals receiving and they have indirect signals receiving. So under this wave tracing method, they need to consider these, and intersection building scenarios are also considered. In these intersection building scenarios, they have considered the parameter of radius and the roughness of the surface is made. So whatever the radius of that particular part and whatever the roughness of that particular surface on which it is basically, it is getting reflected to this particular part. So it is the radius and the surface roughness which is considered for intersection building scenarios. So whenever we do the conventional method, we basically consider that the radius is zero and the roughness of the surface is zero. It means the edges of the building at intersection is assumed to have square corners. We normally assume, for example, in previous slide, if you see, it is a building having some curvature like this. But in conventional system previously, we normally consider those curvatures as square, and we normally consider that they don't have any roughness, the building faces as a smooth surface. It means these two parameters, A and delta H, they are considered zero in conventional method. But for this ray tracing propagation simulation method, they consider these two parameters also. And under these two parameters conditions, obviously their reception process as or the channel model for this particular condition will have better, you can say, performance as compared to the conventional. So under this, they consider distance from the intersection. And if it is at low frequency, then your conventional path loss results in a good increment with major values as distance from intersection instead. But if it is at high frequency, then accuracy of this estimate degraded as distance from intersection increased. So obviously, to have high accuracy of the channel model, you need to consider these models at high frequency. You need to estimate those as a distance from intersections increased. So that is why this propagation simulation technology of ray tracing method should have considerations of other parameters also. So for 5G communication system, the error at high frequency need to be reduced. Another propagation simulation technology proposed method is by NTT Docomo. NTT Docomo is basically a company which has launched IS-95 CDMA standard and WCDMA standard, but now they are working towards this 5G technology propagation model. So they have proposed one method, and in that method they have that the edges of the building at the corners is assumed to be circular. Now they are considering that the building corners are assumed as circular, and if they are considering circular, so in this high frequency band, the roughness of the building surface is also considered. It means this delta H and A parameters are under consideration in this proposed NTT Docomo method. So as shown in this, this is your transmission point, this is your reception point. So this signal is just touching, you can say this in contact with this, it reflected back and received at the reception point. Similarly, it is reflecting from this part to this part to this part to this part. So in this particular part, they have considered it as a circular surface. And also the roughness surface and curved corners they have considered. So when these surface roughness and curved corners, they are at low frequency, so no variations between the calculated and measured values has been observed. But at high frequency, the effect of the surface roughness increases for frequency of 26 GHz and above. It means whenever we need to model a propagation channel for 26 GHz and above frequencies, we need to consider these roughness surface with curved corners also, so that the propagation channel model accuracy should be increased. And it is also observed that with fixed surface roughness value, the error value can be reduced. For example, some of might have must use normally whenever you are working on some topic or you are researching some topic, and there are some you can say at times you are basically at a position that you are not able to achieve the results you want. So we just go through some literature, and some of the literature suggested that we should consider this one parameter should be constant, or this parameter should be this value in the range of this value, and we choose one value and we just compile the results, and we see that there is a variation in the results from the previous values, and we'll get a support of literature also for that. But it is observed that in these conditions, when specifically for this propagation simulation technology model, whenever a fixed surface roughness value has been considered, this error value can be reduced. So this fixed surface roughness value, it means you have so many buildings under your scenarios, and whenever these all the buildings, they have different surface roughness value. So if you consider this building 1 as a roughness value, building 2 roughness value, building 3 roughness value, building 4, 5, 6, and so many. So obviously your model will be complex, will become complex, because you need to consider all the roughness values of all the buildings in between, and you don't know your signal is basically reflecting from which particular building. So obviously you have to take midway, and that is why they considered at a fixed roughness value, that they are considering it approximately same roughness, all the buildings have same roughness value. So whenever they have done this, they observed that the error value is reduced. It means their model is working with good accuracy, and the error value of that model has been reduced. And another point to consideration is distance from intersection. So it means at low frequency, your conventional model results in remain good agreement, but at high frequency, the distance from intersection increase, so accuracy of the estimate will decrease. It means you can say that in this particular part, if this intersection distance has been increased, so obviously there will be degradation in your model path loss propagation. So these are basically in all these slides, but the major concern related to this propagation simulation technology is when we want to discuss these propagation simulations channels or propagation, when we want to do simulations for these propagation channel models, we need to identify parameters related to those channel models those parameters can be your surface roughness, those parameters can be the corners, those parameters can be your distance from the intersection, those parameters can be whether you are designing for low frequency or you are designing for high frequency, and for high frequency, how much high frequency you are consuming, it is for 20 GHz, it is for 60 GHz, or whichever frequency you are using, you can consider under those configuration parameters. So you need to identify your parameters, and with obviously when you increase the number of parameters in your configuration parameters model, you can your model can be complex, but the accuracy of estimate can also be increased. So that is why they have considered different parameters. Different parameters can be considered individually. Those different parameters can be considered in a combination, that you are considering only a roughness value, then you are considering roughness value with intersection, then you are considering roughness value with intersection with distance, and so on. So there are different combinations which you can implement in simulation, which can be implemented in experiments, and you can achieve those results. In one of the literature paper, I haven't mentioned in this slide, but there is a paper from the University of Malaysia, and they have implemented, they have done experiments for these 4 GHz frequencies, 5 GHz frequencies, and about 20 GHz of frequencies. They had done experiments for this urban micro and urban micro scenarios, in outdoor to outdoor scenarios, and outdoor to indoor scenarios, and indoor scenarios also. So they have implemented those experiments using signal generators, using spectrum analyzers, and they have done this, that they have considered one transmitter, they have considered receivers, and the receivers can be in outdoor environment, the receivers can be in indoor environment, it can be urban micro, it can be urban micro. So they have different scenarios, they done these experiments, they identified that under these partitions in indoor environment, our signal strength or our path loss model is working like this. The defined path loss models, they have already considered, which is in the literature. Then they suggested their modified parameters, that this path loss model can implement, can also consider this type of parameter, whether the partitioning values, their roughness and all that. Similarly, for outdoor to outdoor environment also, they have shown these experiments for different data sets. That they have considered so many repetitive experiments in different scenarios, and finally with those data sets, they have analyzed the equations, and then they have proposed the solution for that particular frequency in those type of experiments or scenarios. So we can say that obviously high frequency, the error needs to be reduced, and for reducing of the error, we need to do experiments on different scenarios. We need to implement those experiments, we need to identify the proposed propagation channel models, and we need to suggest some modification. One of our students, an earlier impact thesis, one of our students has implemented below 6 GHz channel models specifically for Ghaziabad region. She was staying in Ghaziabad, and so she has just implemented the path loss propagation model in her area. She tied up with one of the major service provider, mobile service provider, and she has implemented those practical experiments done through their mobile brands, done through their testing equipment, and finally she captured that data that the base station, which was installed 5 to 6 years earlier, has different propagation factors accuracy. But with the time when the building, high-rise buildings have been increased, vegetation has been reduced, or vegetation has been increased, the area, environment or terrain modifications have been done. So under those conditions, obviously that particular propagation model, which was used by the service provider during planning, they have identified that they have some modified changes, and they need to consider some different parameters in their data. So similar behavior can be implemented for high frequencies. Obviously, we need different types of equipment for implementation of these type of experimental studies. Then another model is line of sight probability model. This mobile industry, they have found benefit in describing the loss for path line of sight and non-line of sight conditions. So whenever it is line of sight propagation, it will offer reliable performance in millimeter wave communication. It means if there is no interference between the transmitter and receiver, they are communicating directly, so it is line of sight in communication. And if transmitter, it has some building in between and then it has receiver, or it is somewhere else and it is communicating through this, then it is non-line of sight communication. So this line of sight probability is modeled as a function of 2D transmitter receiver separation distance. And this is based on geometry and layout of the environment or scenario of this. So whatever the scenario, we need to define this line of sight probability. So under this urban micro line of sight probability model, they have identified this 3GPP TR38.901. They have identified these equations for outdoor users, for indoor users, and the parameters that D1 and D2 have been identified as 18 meter and 36 meter. So for line of sight, they have minimum of D1 by D2D for 1 meter and 1 minus exponential of D2D by D2 and exponential of D2D by D2. And for indoor environments, just they have to use D2D out in the formula above instead of D2D. Similarly, 5GCM, they have different models for D1 by D2 model, then New York University squared model. Then METIS has this UMI line of sight probability model, outdoor line of sight D2D, it is again, then indoor user it is again, they have some conditions of D1, D2 and they have conditions for the squared model and D1 by D2 model. Similarly, MM Magic, they have outdoor models, indoor models and D1 and D2 conditions. So this D2D is basically 2D transmitter receiver Euclidean distance, and D2D out is a 2D Euclidean distance of the straight line between transmitter and the building cricket. So these are line of sight probability models which are proposed by different research groups or different bodies, you can say, and they have identified their formulas. So on your requirement as a researcher, we can use these formulas to verify for our experiment or our condition. You can use these formulas as a simulators, in simulators also, and you can have experimental analysis also on the basis of the data received from experiments. So the simulation, basically, there are so many simulators nowadays for propagation channel model implementation. One is of RENCOM. They have the propagation model or and channel model conditions for 5G and other implementations for outdoor and indoor scenario implementation for massive MIMO, for MIMO and so on. Similarly, if you want to work for the protocol levels or you want to work for different, there is Nexin is also there, and they also work on this particular model development. So this is all about our propagation models. These are the references I have used. Some of the references are literature papers which I have read but did not mention in this PPT. If you need, any of you want those literature, one is basically from the 2020, and which is basically published in 2021. It is upon the review of most of the papers. So it is with me. If anybody want to work on this channel models or propagation models for 5G or millimeter wave frequencies, they can ask. I can give them that particular paper, and you can search on Google about the channel models or propagation models for 5G. So these are the references, and if you have any query, you can ask any of you.